In our world, the word promise has lost much of its significance and value due to the ones making promises. The word promise in English comes from the Latin words meaning to send and forward. God is sending forth a word in this verse that we can bank on. So let's take the next few minutes and look at verse 3 of Psalm 1 and the promise of the blessed man. We return once again to this chapter for the 26th day of our 31-day journey into the life of the blessed man. And let's read verses 1 through 3. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The promise for the blessed man. Its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The important thing to remember as we consider any promise is the one making the promise and the promise itself. If the one making the promise is not trustworthy, the promise is worth little to nothing and can even create false expectations and certainly disappointment. Our focus today is solely on the idea of a promise. In the Journal of Business Ethics, I saw an article that said, promise keeping consistently was found to rank last in the hierarchy of workplace values. And why? It couldn't be counted on. We live in a society, a world, and even a church oftentimes where it means very little for man to promise something. Just attend a wedding and recognize the startling and saddening reality that divorce is often seen as an option, even though we make a vow before God. Get that bold willingness to even break our promises made publicly before God and many witnesses. Aren't you thankful Jesus doesn't divorce his bride, the church? Indeed, all the promises of God find their yes in him, 2 Corinthians 1:20. This verse, however, is God's word, and remember what Hebrews 6:18 says, so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. I'm not sure whose promises you're trusting today, but if your hope is in the promise of any human being, whether it be a husband, wife, parent, child, a local church, a business contract, retirement plan, politician, or national policy, I can totally understand why you might be anxious, discouraged, worried, unsure, or fearful. You see, promises made by mankind don't bring true peace, but rather very conditional peace. This promise is being made by God and is a result of meditating on God's word day and night. We will look at the elements of the promise in the next two episodes, Lord willing. But for today, we need to ask some pointed questions involving our trust. It's easy to wonder, is my life spiritually healthy? And we should be asking that question. But the starting point of the inquiry is a two-part question. Number one, are you in the Word of God, meditating on the Word of God throughout the day? Is it the filter for your decisions? And two, are you surrendering to the Word of God in your choices and priorities? Is the Word of God your true authority, or is it just a good idea? When those two things are happening, you don't need to understand why things are the way they are. God gives two elements of prospering, one whose leaf does not wither and one who prospers in all that he does, but says nothing about what this looks like day to day. You don't need to know how things will turn out. You don't need to be approved by those around you. You don't need to have the answers for your future 5 and 10 year plans. You don't even need to know how this promise looks in its current fulfillment. Instead, the question is, do you know him? As a kid, I knew my parents were for me, and they loved me. If they told me there was a special surprise that I would love, I didn't have to wonder if it was good. I knew their heart for me and thus trusted the character of the one promising rather than my comprehension of the promise itself. Do you trust God? We are reminded in Romans 8:32, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Next time you want to doubt God's care or compassion, look at his cross. Next time you want to doubt his sincerity, take a look at his suffering for your sin and for mine. But don't miss this. There's nothing here that says you'll feel like you're prospering. There's nothing that says others are going to say you're prospering. You must trust his evaluation of your life. If not, what do you really view as success? What would you define as your leaf not withering? My guess, if you are one of the ones doubting the validity of this promise in Psalm 1, you're probably not the one meditating on God's word day and night. I say that not as an indictment, but as an invitation to a life of fresh prospering. Don't let a perishing world define the promises of God. Trust his character today. He is faithful and he will do it. 1 Thessalonians 5:24. Though I'm not sure of the origins of this song, how apt it is for our thoughts today. The words, "How wonderful your words, O God, so loving and so true. They feed our hungry hearts and lives and fill our thoughts with you. Beside your living waters, Lord, we drink a life unseen. Forever fruitful in your love, we grow forever green. Apart from you, the source of life, we blossom for a day, but rootless, lifeless, all alone, we quickly die away. You freely share your wisdom, Lord, and daily prove it true. We dance today with heaven's joy, for life is all in you." Till next time, remember, God will fulfill his promise, so don't miss the blessed life by ignoring the source of the truly abundant life. Meditation upon his eternal word.